Martinson Talks Books. Well, in television, as you know, with shows that you watch, sitcoms, they will have, oh, who's that guy I'm seeing there? Or who's that woman? And they're what they call a visiting guest star. But as they leave, you know, they really want to stay, come back, be a regular. It's a little hard when you're doing a show like what, Everybody Loves Raymond, and someone's complaining because they only get $300,000 a week. And you're very lucky to get stage scale. Well, my guest today, Fred Stoller, has written one of the funniest books entitled, Maybe We'll Have You Back, The Life of a Perennial TV Guest Star, and it's published by Skyhorse Publishing. Welcome, Fred.
Thank you for having me, Connie.
And I have to say, it is funny. Anybody really wants to know what it's like to be an actor and a working actor, read this book.
Thank you. That's what I hope, that people just, well, civilians could relate about struggling, trying to get to the next level, or want to know these little things you don't hear in every Hollywood book.
Well, just you a working started guy. Off as a comedian at 13
Not
in
13.
Brooklyn. Oh, you were older?
I think, yeah.
Yeah. For $12, how much did they pay you?
Well, my first job, I think it was called the Jade Fountain in Paramus, New Jersey, and I think it was a Chinese restaurant. I got $15.
Ah. Well,
that's... free food.
Yeah. Some food. At that point, you were still in high school.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
I didn't get the Jade Fountain job then, but I was taking the D train from Sheepshead Bay, Brooklyn, all the way to Manhattan to try to audition at the improvisation, you know, and my parents didn't understand.
Well, you are very funny in describing your parents. I mean, there they are, typical Jewish parents who wanted you to probably be a doctor, a lawyer, or a dentist.
Yeah, or they just didn't understand, because I always say back then, maybe 30 years ago, comedy isn't what it is now, where everyone does stand-up, every college has a course in it. My parents knew Shecky Green, the Catskills. I was a shy, depressed kid. So it made no sense. And I could understand that even when I eventually said I want to quit college to be a comedian, because they go, how are you going to make people laugh? You're so depressed all the time. What? They thought I lost my mind. Well, mostly my mother. My father didn't talk much.
Yeah.
And so I wasn't really a class clown, and obviously, but I just saw it as an end to being a character actor. I didn't know how you became an actor, but I just heard stories about people like Freddie Prinze or Jimmy Walker that did their act at the Improv, got on the Tonight Show, then got to be in a sitcom. I go, okay, I'm shy, but if I just do it once, I'll get discovered. That's what I thought, and I'd had my head down. I couldn't look at the audience, and that almost became my style.
Yeah, and that became your style.
Yeah, not looking at the audience telling stories how my mother couldn't believe I was a comedian.
And especially where you had a mother who said, don't go around the corner almost.
Yeah, everywhere you go, you'll get killed.
Yeah.
She would leave newspaper clippings about people who were killed and to remind me not to go out. If you go to Coney Island, you'll come home in a box, she would say.
And here you are, I think, in one of your first programs down at the bottom.
Yeah, the top one is me on the porch in Sheepshead Bay as a kid, and I think I had a McGovern button on. That might have been 72, and that was at the Jade Fountain in Paramus, other photo, getting $15.
Yeah. From there, though, let's jump ahead, working with David Brenner.
Yes, I had done my act. David Brenner had a short-lived talk show at night, and then I did panel with him, meaning conversation, and and that's getting free food. I'll go back to David Brenner, a friend Joel, who always asked, what free food did you get? He couldn't wait to hear on every set what they fed me. Did you have to go to commissary? So that was the craft service table at Everybody Loves Raymond and a free jacket, King of Queens. But David Brenner, I eventually somehow got hired to be his Chris Elliott, meaning doing little character bits on his show. and just playing an usher, a parking attendant, just interrupting the show. And that led to getting an agent and then having the confidence to come to L.A. to try to audition for TV shows and pilots because I finally got an agent.
Yeah. You are funny, though, about an acting coach.
Oh, yes. Yes,
there's Claudette.
That's their name.
In parentheses.
Yeah, you know, I had to use a few names. Some are real ones. You'll get some dirt. And my friend did a joke I'm taking from it. The book's not a tell-all, it's a tell-partial.
Yeah.
It's, you know, I named some names. My one-night stand with Kathy Griffin and when Norm MacDonald taunted me and some other people. But some, I had a, in L.A., people prey on vulnerable people because people look for answers like, you know, coaches, gurus, whatever. And so I was very nervous auditioning. And so someone recommended this acting coach. Yeah. If you don't get coached before every show, before every audition, you'll forget everything. You'll go back to what you were. You'll be fired. You'll be blacklisted. You'll be. And people get scared. And she created this dependency, not just for money, but money, but just to make herself feel good. And I just talk about this pathological relationship. It was hard to break off because you're scared, you know.
Yeah.
You're walking on eggshells in your life, your career, you're nervous. So you want to, you know, there's a lot of nebulous things that there's no right or wrong for auditioning, acting, careers.
Well, when you talk about you had just been in a show with, I forget, well, Treat Williams was a great, great friend. But you've just been in a show with someone, and you're going up for an ad for something advertising, and by God, there's the guy who had been a star of that show.
Right. Before Matt LeBlanc became superstar in Friends, we worked on this cheesy show called Vinny and Bobby, where I was much skinnier, and the joke was I had a tank top and I'd make muscles, and he was this hunky guy. The star of the show, you know, not too cocky, but hey, I'm Vinny. He was from, what was it called? Yeah, Vinny and Bobby. But then the show got canceled, and I bumped into him at some commercial audition. He kind of was humbled, and, you know, here we are both at a cattle call, signing a list with 100 people. Hey, Fred, you know, he felt like he just went from being, hey, I'm the star of the show, and I'm the geeky skinny guy. So he wasn't a jerk, but it's sort of like, there we are, back waiting online, and then shortly later he got Friends.
Yeah.
And he just not auditioning for commercials anymore.
You had a hot period, too. I mean, with Murphy Brown, with the group there that you, well, I guess as you said, every 3 years you came back.
Murphy Brown, I did like 6 of them, but I had when I did my guest spot on Seinfeld, that was so high profile and such a nice part. And there were a lot more sitcoms in the 90s than, you know, eventually reality TV, 20, you know, game shows, talk shows, you know, The Biggest Loser. So there was a phase where it wasn't as hard as it is now to be a character actor and just go on all these shows as the weird go-to guy, the schnooky guy.
But as I said to you before we started, I see you as a young Jack Lemmon.
Well, tell that to my agent or the world or my mother, you know, but thank you. You know, I would love to be, I get typecast as the nervous, the schmucky guy, the annoying guy, the clerk, the delivery guy, and it would be fun to be that, but as a person that maybe as a kid or is applying for a job, not just, hi, here's the package, but hey, it's a living.
That's right, but we should say you also wrote for Seinfeld. Larry David hired you. He also not quite fired you, but you weren't there.
He didn't bring me back. Yeah, shows the book's called Maybe We'll Have You Back because you hope to be brought back. He didn't say, get out, you're fired. But I kind of knew when 6 weeks left in the season, he goes, hey, no point starting anything else up. I knew, hey, I didn't like that episode, the thing you just pitched. But, you know, I fell into a staff writing job. Actually, the chronology, I did a Kindle single. Do you know what they are?
No.
It's really big on Amazon. They're more than a magazine article, not quite a book. It was called My Seinfeld Year.
Yeah.
You know my favorite year, what that was about?
Yes.
This was not that.
Yes.
It was tumultuous, dealing with Larry, who, if I pitch an idea, he'd sit there and go, how does someone like you buy a shirt?
Yeah.
I can't picture you functioning. You go in, you get dizzy, you're something wrong with you. You know, so just things like that. Or so it did really well, and then it led to getting the book agent, and I've always had this idea. But I kind of knew I never had dreams of being Rob Petrie around the table and laughing and being the TV writer. I always wanted to be a character actor and do my thing, and I knew I wasn't fitting in at Seinfeld as a writer, and it wasn't a round table at the merriment.
Yeah, and one of the pictures here is, again, a funny story of you with the leather jacket, the jacket that someone had given you from one of the sets.
Oh, yeah, it's always special when you get a nice thing. Like, that's what's in the book, the little perks that people don't talk about. On King of Queens, I did a voiceover. I was so touched that Kevin James gave me a nice baseball King of Queens jacket. And I felt, like I said, so touched. This is so special. Then I had a date, or I thought it was a date. I later found out she had a boyfriend, and she was with me thinking, oh, this guy can help my career.
Yeah.
Then they realized, this jerk can't help me. But she borrowed my King of Queens jacket because it was chilly. I thought I'd see her again. And she avoided all my phone calls thinking she was going to keep it. And I was determined. I may be a meek nebbish, but I was going to get that jacket back. These are my special things, my mementos of my show appearances.
Yeah. And you did.
I got it back. I learned to be a little bit, if I could put that aggressiveness in my career, I'd be a star, I'd rule the world. I was determined, I'm going to get that jacket back.
And now, living near the Grove, you got one of those cards that say, give him a free dessert.
For a while, I called myself the mayor of the Grove, because it's like, it's very isolating being a writer, being an actor. You know, you're not like in an office where I go, hey, Deborah, and come in. So it's my little way of bumping into people. And you know, TMZ, I've been on it. They taunt me, like, oh, this jerk's here every day. Don't film him. But for a while, I was getting some free desserts with my Grove card, my VIP.
And you had a friend, Mendy, is that his name?
No. excuse me, when I wrote my Seinfeld episode, it was based on the story that this guy gave me an Armani suit, and he said, you give me a meal, we're even. So we went to Jerry's Deli, and he had soup and soda, and it's not cheap at Jerry's Deli. And it came for like $20. He goes, I'm going to save the meal for another time. So that became my episode, What's a Free Meal? That's the meal, the soup. No, that's not a meal. So, in Seinfeld, I called the restaurant Mendy's. I always thought it's a funny name. There was a basketball referee called Mendy Rudolph. And they used the name, and it turned out by coincidence, there's a deli in Los Angeles called Mendy's. So they exploited that. They have all their ads, go to Mendy's from the Seinfeld episode, where a meal is a meal, soup is a meal. So I ended up meeting Mendy in person, and I pretended to get, so I could get a free meal. I go, it's my favorite restaurant. I based it on this. I was lying for a free turkey dinner.
How did you get Vinny and Fred off the ground?
Okay.
That's really, something to get a movie you wrote made.
Well, we went the independent film route, not with the studios. Long story short, I had what I call the adoring parent I never had. This guy, Vinny, was agoraphobic. He didn't like to leave the house, but he was the happiest agoraphobic. He lived vicariously through me. So if I'd call him up, I'd tell him I was at a video store, a post office, he'd go crazy. Oh, my God, no way. Then he came to stay with me to try to be an extra. That's our poster, Fred and Vinny. And if you see below, we won the Austin Film Festival's Comedy Award.
What year was this?
I think that was 2011.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty recent. It's on Netflix streaming and Amazon and places. And we, my friend Steve Scrovan, he's a writer on Everybody. He was on Everybody Loves Raymond. And basically, he read an early version of this book.
Yeah.
And said, you know, Fred, you're pretty good at this prose, about writing about true stories of your life. Because I was trying to write all these crazy movies, just trying to be a writer, yeah. And oh, this is what they're looking for, robots or Jack Nicholson comedies. And I was always better just writing about me. He goes, why don't you write about your crazy friendship with Vinny? Just to do it. I wrote it. And so it started as a short story. So he had produced a documentary called A Reasonable Man about Ralph Nader and did pretty well, went to Sundance. So I guess he got the bug to do his own thing again. Like, let's make a movie out of this story about your friendship with Vinny. Because he makes a decent and very decent money writing on sitcoms. But, you know, if you're smart like him, you go, well, I want to do a labor of love, just something creative to do it. And he directed it. So we just, he put the money up. We had some hiccups along the road.
Did a film like that cost?
It was about $400,000. It could have been done cheaper, but we did all the legit ways, permits, and he built a little set to look like my apartment. He didn't build it, but paid someone to. And it was cheap, but, you know, but it was with post, with editing and everything. And so it's not cheap. We could have maybe done Gorilla, you know, but we'd have cops chasing us and we'd be tripping because you got to run. Yeah. You have heavy equipment. No, we paid my.
But it won some awards.
It won some awards. It has people like it. It's again, it's on Netflix and.
Yeah. Did it get a distribution?
Yes, that's how it got on. Not a distribution where it's in movie theaters or, you know, on big TV, but distribution today now means getting, like, to get on Netflix, you have to have distribution, you know. Yeah. So it helped get it on, like I said, Amazon, Netflix streaming.
A film like that.
And it was in a Target.
Yeah. What did it do for your career?
I'm just kidding. I was doing the. Well, it really maybe not got me to the next level where I'm Steve Buscemi or anything, but it really lit a fire to seeing what I love most is just expressing myself in my own voice. And, you know, rather than pitching, like, is this what they're looking for? Is this what they want?
Yeah.
So it really lit a fire to write the book and write more stories.
Question: how did your mother react?
She didn't quite understand it because she doesn't understand the internet or an email. Where is this movie? How do you see it? What do you mean? I guess it didn't work. It's on the internet. And finally, I showed her a copy.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's hard for her to understand things if it's not like, you know, at the retirement community on movie night or movie maven night they have, you know, or, and she finally saw it. Goes, it's very sad. So,
but it's very touching. You go down there, and every time you've gone, you want to run. And you made yourself
away. I want to run?
Away.
From
run
my mother.
Back. Yeah. Run back home.
Wait, I always want to go home?
When you go to Florida?
Oh, yes. I thought you meant back to my mother.
Oh, no. It's running from Florida where the retirement community is.
Yeah.
And you went down, and you sort of made yourself listen.
Well, there's a funny story about the book. My uncle read the book. He sent my mother only the last chapter. He said, only read this, the rest will upset you. Because she doesn't like when I say true things, that she was a little negative and afraid and covering her eyes if I was on TV. Like, I can't look. She'd be hiding in the other room, afraid I'm going to fail. And, you know, she didn't understand my career choices, or just, again, I didn't say anything too damning or incendiary? I'm learning bigger words. I could compete with, no, I'm just kidding. But she doesn't like, when I would do stand-up, if I do a joke about her, she goes, a lot of truth is said in jest, you can't let it go. It reminds her of the things. She said, and here in Florida, they don't know me like they know you know me. They think I'm nice. So it's like she's in the witness protection program there.
Yeah, I love it.
It's a new identity. So basically, But there was a nice breakthrough in the book where I used to just shut off to her, like you know, I'm there, but I'm not there. And that she, I tried everything. I used to get frustrated. Why is it always about money? Why do you got to compare me to other people? This is my career.
And her last line was always, "Don't make trouble."
Yeah. So then, I tried being more patient and not letting it bother me, and that got him mad. You're a man of very few words. So then I really explained things, so I had some breakthroughs.
Yeah.
But I still want to run home every time.
Very sweet, very touching at that. But along the way, you've made a lot of good friends.
Yeah, good people. Artie Lang, do you know who he is?
Yeah,
he's such a good guy. He's got a book out, but he doesn't need a plug. He's probably a bestseller, but he's a great guy. I did his show, and we had some fun when I worked on Norm MacDonald's show. The three of us would sneak out and play tennis, and Norm kept throwing rackets and got mad that he's a fat guy. He's beating me at tennis. And it's good. Treat Williams, we talked about earlier, really was, I was like a puppy dog following Treat Williams around because I loved him in the movie Hair.
Yeah.
So some good people, some people. Not so good.
Yeah, but they'll be much better after they see how well the book does. You're going to be in for a big surprise, Fred. And I know you're planning sort of the Jewish book fairs.
I didn't know there was a big circuit. And I'm this November, I'm going to Detroit. That's the biggest one I heard. And Ann Arbor, St. Louis, Atlanta. Not New Jersey. No. Cherry Hill and San
Florida.
Diego.
And Florida has
I
the
didn't
big
get,
one.
I didn't get Florida. My mother was on the board.
Oh.
She voted the Jewish Book Festival. No, I don't like the book. It says things I don't want people to know. It puts me in a bad light. So she voted me out of Florida.
You mentioned just briefly in the beginning your sister Cindy.
Yes.
Yeah.
She reads the books. You are good.
What does she do now?
She's a social worker in the Bronx, I believe. She lives in New York. Somewhere where she has to drive her car there.
Yeah, Westchester.
Probably. New City? Do you know New City?
Yes, I do. New City? Yeah.
Yes, that's where she lives.
Okay.
And her husband drives a car to a train. Then takes a 2-hour train ride and goes to work somewhere in Wall Street. My friend they visit was complaining about something like because he's into some hobby and sometimes some nonsense. They don't have the hobby. And he goes, I take 3 hours of trains and your life sounds good.
Anyhow, we know that.
Anyway.
Yes.
She's going, Fred, what are you?
Yes.
I should do a joke in my act. I'm talking to a girl on the phone. I know the conversation's over. She goes, anyway.
Yes. What might have been is really one of the interesting chapters, too, of what could have happened.
Yeah.
A
lot of things. Close to things. Could have had this lead. It's just random, but it could have been a lot worse.
Yep. And yet there's the game shows, and we are still dollars and artist directors. All of it coming up for you under Norm MacDonald and the jacket.
Oh, he stole a jacket too. I forgot. A woman stole a jacket, and Norm, he didn't really deliberately go, I'm going to steal his jacket, but it somehow ended up with him, and he was torturing me, not giving it back.
Yes.
You and that jacket.
And frankly, it's a great book. I mean, as I say to you, I read it and laughed out loud.
I
don't think you have to have a relative in the business in order to love it.
Oh, thank you. It's the type of book I would want to read only because I like underdogs, and with sports I like the people that are trying to make the big time and get a little taste of it and have to go back to the minors and come up and have a little glory.
Yeah,
and remind them,
because the story of you going on the Warner Brothers lot, and A, they don't have your name at the gate.
Oh, sure.
Then you get in, and you have one of those dungeons as a dressing room.
Oh, you know, we're near it. It's like a little porta potty almost.
And then trying to go say hello to old friends, and they won't let you on the lot there.
Yeah, they go, what do you want here? I want to say hi to the cast of Murphy Brown. Who are you? I thought I'm family because I was here last week. Get out of here.
Yeah. No. But that will change. Anyhow, I love it. As I said, Fred, will you sign my book?
Absolutely.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can see some of the old shows there, as well as go to YouTube, because this show will be on there within a few weeks. And go back.
I'm glad my mother doesn't get YouTube, because she'll see this.
She'll love it. Then you can go to Claremont Graduate Digital Library that has digitized about 2,000 shows. So you're never alone if you have a computer. But support your local library. Wherever you are, libraries need all the help they can get. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Oh, yeah, you know, we didn't have these bookstores or the money, and I would just escape. And, you know, I remember on Nostrand Avenue in Brooklyn, that library, just coming in, getting a book, hoping my mother would read it to me. Didn't always happen.
And if you're going to that library, there is a great book by Joe Sacco, an artist, called The Great War, about World War One. Remember there was a World War One? Here it is.
Whoa.
And somehow in seeing an artist who has portrayed it, it's the horror of war, and what in God's name are we doing being in war? Go to your library, read about it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much,
Fred. Thank you so much for having me. This is a war story.